you guys doing?
Very well.
See you all again, good to be here. It's got another beautiful day to celebrate together. And so, very interesting topic for this month, calling, actualizing potential. So I want to speak to that a little bit, if I may. Couple of things, I was at a conference a few weeks ago, the 50th anniversary of the field of transpersonal psychology. That field combines psychological science with spiritual traditions. One of the keynote speakers was Roger Walsh. He wrote some seminal books early in the field, titles like Paths Beyond Ego, and another wonderful title called Essential Spirituality, where he looks at all the spiritual traditions across history and across the globe and looks at the common denominators of those. So skills like empathy, compassion, gratitude, wisdom, humility, ego, transcendence are common denominators across almost all traditions. And so in that book won lots of awards, so I highly recommend it. Again, the title is Essential Spirituality. And so he started his talk with a comment that strikes me as appropriate to our theme by quoting Suzuki, a famous Zen philosopher, who said, you're perfect as you are, and you can also use a little work. So there's something about that that resonates in terms of a deep acceptance of who we are and what we are at every point in time, and yet combining that with ambition of development, naturalizing our potential. And so the notion of embracing both and finding a balance in both. When my mother was, when she was younger, in her teens, went to Juilliard in New York. She was a musician. She's very talented, she has perfect pitch, so she hears music and she sits down and plays it instantly. It was very frustrating as a child taking music lessons from her. Piano lessons, she said, just hear it, just play. I'm trying. So I was doing it hit and miss, and she would just sit down and play it. Throughout her late teens, she eventually met my father. She transitioned to away from some of that for a decade or more to start a family with my brothers and myself. And eventually, she, in her 40s, she decided to go back to school and start in community college. And a lot of her peers at the time, who were of a similar age, said, what are you, nuts, starting college from scratch in your 40s? By the time you get your advanced degree, you'll be in your 50s. And she said, I'll be in my 50s anyway. This will be my 50s pursuing something I love, getting an advanced degree. So that struck me as an early important lesson. One of many that stayed with me. When I was an undergraduate at UCLA, I had an opportunity to apply that lesson. I was third year bioengineering, and I always liked science, and I have two older brothers. One is a computer science professor, the other is a mathematician, and so there was always those kinds of discussions around the house, and so I was a big fan of what the world is actually like in many fields of science. And so I thought, well, that's the only legitimate thing to pursue, even though I had already had a passion for psychology and philosophy, both Eastern and Western. And so at some point around third year, after taking a lot of the physics, chemistry, biology, calculus, I was sitting around, I think I was complaining about the biochem labs or something like that to a friend of mine. He said, you know, I've been hearing you complain more and more over the last couple of months. Why don't you just do psychology and philosophy? That's what you read in your spare time anyway. And it was one of those moments in life where the heavens opened up, the angels sing. Wow, is that actually an option? Yeah, that is an option. So a week later, I was out of the School of Engineering, taking classes in psychology and philosophy. And so I then proceeded to get a PhD in research psychology, because I was still a little bit attached to the research side, the research side of things. And so I did that, but then the growing passion I had for what is wisdom and how it's acquired over the lifespan and so on beckoned for and other, other components, like the clinical components and motivational emotion components. So that took me in the clinical direction, which was also a transition. So there, I had a few mentors in the science field that were a little disappointed that I transitioned to that. They mentored me through the research side of things, doing a postdoc at UC Irvine, and I was slated towards a tenured position there, and it was all set up, but the calling was towards what wisdom is, and the awareness that there's more to it than just the cognitive components, the thinking components. It's much deeper, much broader. So that took me in the direction of clinical and counseling, lifespan development, and several other fields. So as I was doing that, the message started becoming clearer around all of that. And of course, coming across people that said similar messages, people like Abraham Maslow talked about self-actualizing our potential, fulfilling needs, the hierarchy of needs, and so on. And as you come across, as you start fulfilling your potential, embracing your calling at any age, in any area, you start almost surprisingly running into ideas and people who've made similar decisions. And so there's a powerful synergy and positive feedback loops that starts building momentum. Initially, it takes some energy and courage to do that because there are things that stand in the way. Inertia stands in the way. Fears is a big one that stands in the way. So I want to talk about that a little bit as well. There is the notion of we're developing across time, and sometimes we build our boat in a harbor, and it's a wonderful boat. It's safe in a harbor. There's no waves in the harbor. We know what we're in for. We know what to expect. But that's not what boats are made for, to stay in the harbor, right? So they're there to go into sea. But the sea has uncertainties. We have to lose track of the harbor to get to the next shore. And that's full of uncertainty and full of risk. Sometimes it's the devil you know that you want to stick to. And so it's a painful equilibrium that sometimes keeps us in place rather than developmentally moving forward. Again, at any age, at any stage of life, the assumptions we're making and the fears we're embracing rather than letting those go. And there are techniques for letting fears go, like many of you have heard around cognitive distortions, things like all or nothing thinking, catastrophizing, fortune telling. We assume we know what the future holds and some of the dangers around that, and we make them more dramatic than they typically are. The anticipatory anxieties are typically a lot worse than life itself. Mm-hmm. People that have all sorts of fears and phobias around, say, flying or heights or things like that is an extreme version of it, but we're all in a continuum with milder versions of fears that typically don't pan out. Roosevelt famously said, we have nothing to fear but fear itself. There's something very deep in that. What's worse, the outcome of what our fears are, or living day to day in fear? So we're sentencing ourselves to that constraint, to that almost jail of not fulfilling our potential. And that's so sad, much worse in my mind than any potential outcome of fear itself. So we want to talk about that because the local equilibrium is a powerful trap. Just stay in that equilibrium, and people and things keep us there as we want to go into another stage. And so if I had a, as an instructor, I sometimes feel hindered when I don't have a whiteboard behind me, but you could visualize a graph that looks like mountains with higher and higher peaks. Each peak is a different life stage with a more developed place of equilibrium. And once you're in a local equilibrium, up here, it's pretty comfortable. Why leave it? You know the people around there, you're getting a lot of support, you're expert in what you're doing. Why take a dive into an uncharted territory with things we don't know in order to get to the next higher level of equilibrium? So a lot of energy and processes and dynamics are working against us for that. And it has to be weathered and acknowledged, and the fears around that explicitly made aware, and then skill sets to overcome those fears. Otherwise, we're highly motivated to stay in the same equilibrium, and all the forces, including social people around us and psychological forces, keep us there. So there's an aspect of recognizing, you know, that's the pathway we can be on and how to get past that. So complacency is the trap. It's good enough. Even pretty good is good enough. When I see clients in private practice, they sometimes say, you know, I'm going through all these challenges, I wish I was more normal. I say, really? Normal? Normal is not that impressive. Normal is plenty of anger, and stress, and anxiety, and complacency, fears. Do you really want to be normal? There's a lot of amazing things in this world on the other side of normal. And so, what are some of those things? Emotional intelligence, less fear, high levels of gratitude practice, high levels of ego transcendence, balance between self-care and care for others, and compassion towards others. And that's a moving target, so that keeps changing over time as a practice, finding the new versions of those balances. Opportunities to practice, as you know, is one of my mantras, and life is full of opportunities to practice for all these skill sets. And with high frequency practice, it takes us way beyond normal. And why not embrace that? We use such little capacity of our brain and of our abilities. My favorite analogy is many of us, as we navigate our way through life, our brain is almost, the way we're using our emotions and cognitive abilities and so on in the present form, is almost like using a computer as a paperweight. Imagine your laptop, you use a paperweight to hold down papers like a rock. That's almost close to what we typically do, which is just so sad. We can do so much more. And the evidence of that is in our triumphs. When you see that you overcome something, and then you learn the wisdom from that, and the skill sets that life forces upon us sometimes, right? So why not keep that going? So a lot of times in early youth and adolescence, we learn very quickly, and then in early adulthood, it starts leveling out. Middle adulthood, it just keeps not being that steep of a learning curve, so the ability to keep it going. There's another interesting balance between learning new things and applying old wisdom. Assimilation versus accommodation is in Piaget's words. So when we assimilate existing things into their existing knowledge versus, the world is giving me information that my existing knowledge may not be enough. Let me update my model of the world, add some more information, and then see it in a new way, accommodate the world. So finding a balance between assimilation and accommodation is an ongoing life challenge. And if we know we're doing it, if we have explicit awareness that it's a challenge, so we can do that explicitly and invite new information and invite change. We can't change all the time. Literally every 10 minutes, we can't change our opinion. If we do that, people would call us what?
Schizophrenic.
Okay, well, a little extreme.
Wishy-washy.
Not really keeping. And if we don't hardly ever do it, what would they call us? Stuck in our ways, obstinate, rigid. So somehow we find a balance between them where we're sensitive to change and learning, but at the same time we have some stability in applying knowledge and wisdom as we learn it. There's a wonderful quote that I looked up again that I saw in Washington, D.C. in the Jefferson Memorial. Some of you may have seen this, so I'll read it to you. With regards to change and evolution, he applies it to our political system, but it certainly applies to us in our personal life. I'm not an advocate for frequent changes in laws and constitutions, but laws and institutions must go hand in hand with the progress of the human mind. As that becomes more developed, more enlightened, as new discoveries are made, new truths discovered, and manners and opinions change, with the change of circumstances, institutions must advance also to keep pace with the times. We might as well require a man to wear still The coat which fitted him as a boy, a civilized society is to remain ever under the regime of their barbarous ancestors. So it's a powerful quote, and by Thomas Jefferson it applies to this day, the notion that we are growing, and the attitudes, the beliefs that we've had years ago, we no longer apply. It's never too late to change them, and it's always high time to do an update and to see what applies now, in what way, and to actualize the current potential that may not have existed then. I see a lot of couples, I wanted to apply this to relationships, I see couples in private practice, and you'll be amazed how much of my time is spent in the initial session trying to come to an agreement of reducing yelling and name calling. So we're all adults, so when we were 5 years old, there was a lot of yelling and name calling, but come on, it's been a few decades since then. Surely we could do a little better than that. And I'm not excluding myself of never having some frustration or irritation and so on, but surely we can bring those to very low levels if we practice. And so just even that alone would be a huge benefit. And so things like when we start feeling ourselves get frustrated or irritated, what's the first thing we can do? Three or four deep breaths. It's a no-brainer, literally a no-brainer. The breath. And letting thoughts come and go. At the same time, once that opens up that space, becoming aware of what are some of the cognitive distortions. What were my expectations of the situation that contributed to my own frustration? Were they realistic? For example, I can't believe that person insulted me like that. Because no one should ever insult me ever under any circumstances, right? If that's my expectation, I'm going to be disappointed. So I'm setting myself up for disappointment. It would still be, even if I knew that, that's coming some percentage of the time, it would still be a little unpleasant, but it wouldn't be radically unpleasant. It wouldn't be horrendous as we make it out to be because of the impossible just happened. It's not impossible. Same thing with traffic. Can't believe there are all these cars on the road. How dare all these people drive on my streets? So we bring ourselves to a sense of realism, the so-called cognitive distortions, the irrational beliefs from rational emotive therapy, Albert Ellis, cognitive distortions, via cognitive therapy, Aaron Beck. This stuff has been done, the psychological science around how to do this with high frequency of practice. It doesn't take years, it just takes a few weeks, a few months of practice. And we just get really good at it, so we start actualizing our potential, not just by reducing anger, stress, anxiety, depression, but by doing that also developing skills where the reductions of those things are just a byproduct of the skills. The stuff these skills also gives us is opportunities to have dramatically richer relationships, not just ones with less anxiety, stress, anger, less arguing or yelling, but much more empathy, compassion, graciousness, nurturing. One of the things I ask couples is, when your partner walks into the room, do you keep doing what you're doing? And maybe just give kind of an obligatory nod, hey, how's it going? Or do you stop doing what you're doing, get up, and give them a hug? And why does that stop? We habituate to all sorts of things in life, and we don't seem to practice as much gratitude or what I encourage them to do, go back to a first date situation. Imagine you're in a restaurant and you show up a little early, and then your date comes and shows up. Let's say you're reading the newspaper or watching something or texting on your phone, and your date shows up and they're standing at the table and you say, hey, what's up? And you start texting. I'm not sure they would sit down, and even if they did, I'm not sure there would be a second date. Right? So why do we do that? Why are we more vigilant and gracious and so on a first date, and presumably with someone we don't even know, and yet someone who we presumably love and know well, we lose that altogether and we just take it for granted. So I would add that to our practices. If someone you care about walks into a room, give them your full undivided attention for 30 to 60 seconds at least. And so I ask couples sometimes, when was the last time you gave your partner a hug and a kiss when they walked into the room? People have been married 20 years, 30 years. And and they say, it's been years since we did that. And that is so sad. And when we talk about doing things together, like date night and things like that, they say, well, you know, we've got kids and this and that, and we don't have time, and we sleep deprived. And yes, there's lots of challenges in life. But do we really not have 30 seconds to get up and give a hug? All of us got here today, people were hugging each other left and right, including myself. There was plenty to do, but there's always time for that. And so it's not so much the actual time, it's a state of mind of, it's kind of like a childlike state of mind of innocence and excitement and newness and affection, and emotional intelligence. So it's all practicable, and it's fun to do, and it's profound. So the encouragement is to be a lot more ambitious in development, actualizing potential in all different areas, including in relationships. It's a powerful thing, and so to be ambitious, almost like a child. There's a fun story of little Johnny drawing a picture, and teacher comes by and says, asks, "What are you drawing?" And little Johnny says, "I'm drawing a picture of God." And the teacher sort of condescendingly says, nobody knows what God looks like. And little Johnny beams with pride and says, they will now. So there's something powerful in that on a few levels. One is, there's this pure cuteness level, there's that. The innocence of that. But there's part of that that makes it funny that we sort of assume little Johnny doesn't know what God looks like. That's what makes it amusing. But the ambition that he has to draw something and have confidence that that may be what God looks like, that's impressive. And why not have some ambitions along those lines? We can bring some humility to that as adults too. It's like, well, this is what I'm thinking, or this is how it feels. There's no reason to think well, that's necessarily the reality of the situation, but it sure feels important to me. It sure feels something real about this. So we can bring confidence with humility to keep the confidence from tipping over to arrogance. So having some self-actualizing our potential is one thing, but still staying open and flexible to what comes. So there's some messages around that, so staying open. Skills like discernment, mindfulness are powerful. And again, reducing fears. Pick up signals of our calling. Life will present its signals. It's like radio waves, but if we're not tuning into it, and even if when we are tuned into the right station, if we've got massive noise around us, we simply won't hear the music coming through the radio. Fear is the noise. Assumptions, cognitive distortions is the noise. If we can't calm those down through meditation and cognitive reframing, recognizing it's okay, whatever comes is okay, we'll work with it. We talked about this a little bit earlier this morning. You either get what you want and celebrate it and have fun, or life presents an opportunity to gain wisdom. And wisdom is what we get when we don't get what we want. And so to just have a sense of that is kind of an openness to life, and just let what comes, and be sensitive to it, but also to develop the skills so when it does come, we know it when we see it, in lots of forms, in the form of people, in the form of opportunities, in the form of insights. So rather than seeking out titles in terms of what defines success in terms of actualizing our potential, I wanted to kind of finish with that. It's not the titles, it's not the money. We already know money is not correlated with happiness and well-being. There's lots of science around that. That's been done. Lots of spiritual traditions and now there's decades of science around that. We know it's not the titles. We know it's not how many letters are behind your name. One of the advantages of having done a couple of PhDs is I can stand up and say, PhDs don't really matter much. Mm-hmm. If I hadn't done them, say, well, you're just disgruntled because you don't have one. Mm-hmm. I have two. I can tell you it doesn't matter much. And I work with people at Stanford that are Nobel Prize winners. They're arguably the smartest brains on the planet, and that doesn't matter that much. It's cool. It's an amazing place to be, to brainstorm and intellectual richness. But when, at the end of the day, what's the level of kindness? Some of them are not that kind. Empathy, compassion, gratitude, wisdom, humility. Some of them are not that humble. It's, I guess when you win a Nobel Prize, it's easier not to be humble. But if you think about where we're all going to be in 100 years, it's a little easier to be humble. And sometimes we forget that. And so we can do both. We can get skilled along the way, actualize our potential with all these skill sets we keep naming. We can be more open to all these directions. And lastly, probably it's probably worth quoting, many of you know the quote by Hillel that's on the bottom of my email that I send out. It's part of my email signature. Is, not for myself, and who am I? Self-care, actualizing that potential, exercise, eating well, and so on, sleep. If I'm only for myself, then who am I? So empathy, compassion to others, ego transcendence. And if not now, when? What are we waiting for? Right? So if I'm only for myself, if I'm not for myself, then who am I? If I'm only for myself, what am I, and if not now, when? It's powerful. And so we combine those together, naturalize the potential, and with the ego transcendence. And it's probably, some of you know that I ask my students to bring jokes in to classes, and we start our classes with that. And at first they were surprised, well, what do jokes have to do with psychology, or taking exams, or. And I said, you'll see later as we talk through it. And as you look at psychology and lightness of being and not taking yourself too seriously, it starts becoming very apparent what humor has to do with all that. So at first, they were kind of passive about the whole thing. Then I said, you know, here's what we'll do. We're going to take a survey. You're going to bring in jokes and quotes, and we're going to take a vote. Whoever has the funniest jokes and the most inspirational quotes gets an extra credit point towards their grade. And you'll be amazed how much they started bringing jokes at that point. And so that's what we do in the beginning of classes now for the last few years. And they love it. So here's a precious one that somebody brought in. Some of you already probably have heard this one. I heard one version of it, but this was a fun version. That the combination of that the work is in the practice itself, it's at a practical level. So self-actualizing potential sometimes takes an exotic note, but sometimes it's not that exotic. In fact, most of the time it's just in everyday life. It's when someone cuts us off on a freeway, that's an opportunity to practice, standing at line at Starbucks. It's when the daily frustrations hit in relationships. That's what makes all these things such wonderful opportunities to practice. And so a couple of jokes around that. One was from the former Secretary of Defense, Panetta, who has the Panetta Institute. His wife runs that in Monterey, and I was at a meeting where he dropped in while he was Secretary of Defense. And the theme of the evening is how we're making a difference at a practical level. And so what does it mean to be practical in terms of our contribution and growth and so on? And so his joke was two boxers, a priest and a rabbi at a boxing match, and two boxers are at the ring, and the fight is about to start. At the beginning, one of them does this. And the rabbi turns to the priest and says, what does that mean? And the priest says, not a damn thing if you can't fight. So there's something to be said about having an eye towards grace and things beyond us. At the same time, we're where the rubber meets the road with hard practice. The other one around those is the priest shows up at Heaven's Gate, and St. Peter just gives him a hard time. Why do you deserve to go in? And grills him for hours, and finally says, okay, fine, you can go in. As he's walking in, St. Peter just waves in the bus driver behind him. And priest sees this, goes back to the gate. I don't understand. I'm pious. I was prayed every day. I was a man of God. Me, you give a hard time. This guy just waltzes in. What's the story? Says, look, when you preached, some listened, some didn't. When that man drove, everybody prayed. There is this practicality of the outcomes of what we're actually doing. And I'll finish. finish with this last one, where the skill sets, we do have these opportunities to practice in everyday life in different ways, and it doesn't take anything exotic or titles or, so the Buddhist monks in full gore goes up to a New York hot dog vendor, and the first thing he says is, make me one with everything. Buddhist humor. And so he gives him $20 and gets the hot dog, and the hot dog vendor doesn't give him anything back. And the Buddhist monk says, what was my change? And the hot dog vendor says, change comes from within. So then the Buddhist monk is walking around, we'll finish with this, I think for a native New Yorker, for says I'm out of town, asking for directions, how do I get to Carnegie Hall? And of course the native New Yorker responds, practice, practice, practice. And so that's the key central message of all of this. We have daily opportunities to practice dozens of times a day of mindfulness, emotional intelligence, gratitude, empathy to others, putting ourselves in their shoes, taking deep breaths when we feel frustrated, and so on, so the emotional intelligence, recognizing those, all those skill sets, every day. Encouragement is use those opportunities to practice, practice, practice. Thank you.